Good afternoon, everybody. So this is the fourth lecture in the series on differentiation on R. So today we will be concentrating on mean value theorem. At the outset, let me tell you something, a trade secret, it's not well known even in the trade, is in differential calculus, in the theory of differentiation, there are two important results. In fact, I would say only two important results. What are they? They are chain rule and mean value theorem. Whenever you want to compute the derivative, the standard trick is try to express the function as composition of various functions. And those functions may be simpler to compute the derivative so that you can do that. And second thing is mean value theorem. Almost whenever you want to use any notion about a derivative and deduce some consequence, mean value theorem will play a role. Okay. So mean value theorem is, I would say, it's a real heart of the differentiation theory. Okay. So let us look at mean value theorem. So if all of you have a pen and paper, draw some pictures like we did for Rolle's theorem. Okay. So I want you to draw a graph of a function from FA, from AB to R. And this is continuous and differentiable on the open interval AB. Okay. And I don't expect this. It may or may not happen, but this is not part of the hypothesis. Right? Now, look at the chord joining the points AFA on the graph and BFB on the graph and try to see some pattern. Okay. So, what's the pattern I want to look at? I want to look at something like this. So I have A here and I have B here. Then I look at the chord joining FA and this is BFB. This is AFA. Now do you see that there is a point somewhere, okay? The tangent at that will be parallel to the chord. How many of you believe this? Yes? There are actually many points in this graph. Yeah? So, what is the slope of this chord? The slope of the chord is f of b minus f of a by b minus a. What do I want to say? There exists some point, and don't hold me, my picture may not be very correct, so you should not say this is not exactly parallel. Okay, something like this. Okay, there is a point C, and what is the slope of this tangent line at this point? This is C comma FC. The slope is given by F dash C. So what are we claiming? The slope of this chord is same as the slope of the tangent line at this point. That is, we are claiming there is a point C. Where does it exist? That C exists between A and B. Do you understand this? Geometrically, is that clear? Say yes if you understand. Okay, right. So this is the theorem we want to prove. So what is the theorem we want to prove? The mean value theorem says, let f be a function from AB to R. Let me write it as usually you see in books, f is continuous where on AB. Then two, f is differentiable on the open interval AB. Then you want to say there exists C in the open interval AB so that f dash C equal to f of b minus f of a by b minus a. Okay, this is the geometric reason, because this equality of this, the left side is the slope of the tangent at the point C. This is the slope of the chord joining AFA with BFB. But in analysis, the better way of writing this one, there is a better way of writing will be f of b minus f of a equal to f dash c into b minus a. Yeah. Is the theorem clear? Yeah. So we want to prove that. Now again, if you go back, the basic idea is, remember, this is slightly refinement of your which theorem? Rolle's theorem. Do you see that why? If f of a equal to f of b, this side is zero. And b is not equal to a, therefore f dash c must be zero. You understand that? Therefore, this is a more general version of Rolle's theorem. So like in analysis, in mathematics, what do? We reduce this theorem to Rolle's theorem. Okay. How do I reduce it to Rolle's theorem? Remember, I am not assuming f of a equal to f of b. Therefore, what do? I construct a new function out of f so that Rolle's theorem can be applied. Now let's go back to where is that? I'm missing my picture. Yeah. Look at this. This is what I want. Right? Now how do I get? So what I do is I'm looking for a function g such that g of a equal to g of b. Do you understand that? Yeah. But notice that this point here, this think of this. This is a graph of some function, call it L of x. L of x is for line. It's a line segment joining AFA to BFB. Right? So what is the value of L at A? F of A. What is the value of L at B? F of B. Therefore, if I take my G of x to be F of x minus L of x, okay, then G of A will be zero, because L of A is also f of A is also f of A. And same thing here. You understand? Now this L of X, this is a line segment, therefore it will be a linear function, therefore it will also be differentiable. Don't worry, we will write everything explicitly. Do you understand this? I'm giving the geometry. I'm not simply saying consider this function as the textbooks or teacher would write. I'm trying to say how to get this function G. How do I get the function g from fx? We look at the value of this function. Now, how do I write this function? You understand this? Now, you can write this explicitly. How will you write it? So, what is the line joining x1, y1, x2, y2? What is the equation of the line? That is, I don't know how you write y1 minus y1 by y1 minus y2 equal to x minus x1 by x1 minus x2 or whatever it is. Yeah. Now you can solve for y equal to this. But remember, this must be of the form y equal to mx plus c. Right. Now m I know. M must be the slope. Slope is f of b minus f of a by b minus a. Right. Then what do I want? When I put y equal to f a or f b, then x equal to a, then I can solve for c. Do you understand this? Are you following what I'm saying? Please say yes if you understand what I'm saying. This is the equation of the line. I know m, and I know this line has to pass through AFA, BFB. So I have to find c. To find c, substitute y equal to FA, x equal to a, then I would have solved it. You understand? Okay. So in principle, I can do that, but I will do the same thing with a slightly different twist. The reason for that, okay, is this. So we'll consider the function g of x equal to fx minus lambda x. So that choose lambda you will see that's exactly the same thing we are getting. 2 lambda, so that g of a equal to g of b. So what is g of a? F of a minus lambda a equal to f of b minus lambda b. That means f of b minus f of a, bring to this side, that's going to be equal to lambda into lambda b minus lambda a. Lambda b goes here, right? Therefore lambda equal to f of b minus f of a by b minus a. Therefore the function is f of x and f of b minus f of a by b minus a into x. Do all of you understand this? Are you sure? It's now easy to check. Put g of a, I am going to get f of a, right? Then what do I get here? Yeah, I should get this as 0. Therefore, I can now use g is continuous. That's clear. Why? G is f of x minus some scalar multiple of first degree polynomial. Okay, or simply the first degree polynomial. Therefore, g is continuous. For the same reason, g is differentiable. Because f is given to be differentiable, this is a first degree polynomial. We know the, from our earlier algebra of differential functions, g is differentiable also. Right? And g of a equal to g of b. Therefore, by Rolle's theorem, I know there is a c in the interval a, b, so that g dash c is 0. But g of x is fx minus this. Therefore, g dash c is what? 0 implies this is f of x is f dash c minus f of b minus f of a by b minus a into what? Yes, how many of you understand this? Yeah, because x is a first degree polynomial, this is a constant, therefore this one. Therefore, I have here f dash c equal to f of b minus f of a by b minus a. How many of you understood the proof? Okay. Right, so this is the mean value theorem. Now let me again write under stated conditions the way I want to write it. Suppose x and y, suppose f is a function from an interval j to r, let me assume it's differentiable on all of j. J could be any interval, right? And suppose you give 2 points x and y in j, right? Now since it's an interval, assume with our loss of generality x is less than y. Okay, the entire interval xy will be contained in J, right? Because in interval, all points in between x and y will also be in J. Do you all understand that? Okay, therefore, what do I have now? So I can apply the mean value theorem to say f of y minus f of x equal to some f dash of t into y minus x. You understand? This is the typical way we will be applying mean value theorem. To make sense of mean value theorem, what I have to do? I have to make sure I am going to apply it to the interval x to y. This x to y is contained in J. F is differentiable on J. Therefore, f is continuous on J. Therefore, f is continuous on the interval closed and bounded, closed interval x, y. And since f is differentiable at each point of j, it is going to be differentiable at all the points in the open interval x, y. Therefore, mean value theorem can be applied. Do all of you understand this? Okay. Now, this is the formulation most often you will be using. Okay. This is where I'm going to give a secret, because theorem is not by itself is very useful. You have to understand what does it signify? What are the typical applications? For me, for any analyst, the typical application is, suppose you give me a function f from R to R, for some reason I have to estimate something like fx minus fy, let us say, or fy minus x. Estimate meaning I have to put it there, right? If I have to estimate, what my first impulse will be, okay, if f is differentiable, if f is not differentiable, I will assume f is differentiable and try to do that. Then I know fx minus fy will be equal to some f dash into y minus x. Therefore, this modulus is same as this modulus. Okay, this y and x are given, therefore I don't have to worry about. Therefore, I have to look for whether I know any estimate for the derivative. Then I have an estimate for mod fx minus fy. This is the real use of mean value theorem. How many of you understand what I'm saying? Please say yes if you understand. Okay, hereafter in your life, if you continue to do mathematics, the moment you have real valued functions, fx minus fy, you want to estimate, you should immediately think of if it's one variable or several variable or even in a Banach space, what you should look for is how to make use of mean value theorem. Because its major idea is to give an estimate for this. Let us give some examples of this now. Okay. Why is my cursor missing? Oh, this fellow has come here. Oh, okay. I was searching for him on the right side. Okay. The first obvious thing is this. Suppose f is a function from J to R. Assume this is differentiable. As usual, this is, remember, as somebody mentioned the other day, I then told him I never define differentiability on any domain. Whenever I say f is differentiable, I expect the domain to be an interval. I am not saying it has to be open interval, it's an interval, that's it. Okay, this is an interval. Okay, assume that f dash of x is 0 for all x in J. Then I want to say f is, all of you know what is the answer, f is a constant. Okay, now just using the notion of derivative, you cannot prove that f is a constant. You understand that? Suppose f is a constant, I want to prove, start with the, okay, A in J and X in J, I have to prove Fx equal to Fa for every X. You understand that? If I prove that, then it's a constant. Right? By looking at the difference quotient and the notion of derivative, you cannot conclude F is a constant. The simplest and the best way to do that is mean value theorem. Notice, so I am fixing A and fixing X. You understand? A may be less than X or greater than X, I don't care. But mean, now notice that, so I have J, I have some X. I don't know what is A, what is X. So let us pretend you don't know that. Right? Then what do I know? I can write Fx minus Fa. Now what does mean value theorem say? Mean value theorem says there is a T in between A and X. If A is less than X, A less than T less than X. If X is less than A, then X less than T less than A. So we simply say there is a T in between A and X, so that it is F dash T into X minus A. Do you understand that? But what is our assumption? F dash is 0 at every point of J. Therefore, this side is 0. What does that say? Fx equal to Fa. What is X? X is any element in there. I am fixing X. Right? For every element X in J, Fx minus Fa is 0. That means Fx equal to Fa. That means F is a constant. Yeah, please clear your yes and then make a fresh yes if all of you understand, please. Okay. Notice that you cannot prove it otherwise. Directly, you cannot deduce from the notion of derivative. Even though there some proofs are there, but it's more complicated than this. This is very trivial proof and easy to know. And this also tells you an important part. Do all of you understand this? Now comes the problem, why did we use the interval? Because as I said, I define differentiability only on interval. But if you have gone through my lectures on continuity, you will see that I have defined continuity on any subset of R. Whereas when it came to differentiability, I insisted the domain must always be an interval. You can ask whether one can generalize this notion. Okay. So yes, we can do that. Okay. Suppose I have a set, let us call it U, which is union of disjoint union. Of course, it will be disjoint union of open intervals. Disjoint union of open intervals. Okay. That means U equal to J1 union J2 union Jn. Need not even be finite, but let's assume. And intersection from any two intervals will be empty. Then suppose f is a function from u to r. I say f is differentiable on u if f is differentiable at x and for every x in some j. That is differentiable on each and every j. Does this make sense to all of you? So keep a very simple picture so that don't worry about infinite, etc. Let's assume this. Suppose I have this, okay? This is one interval J1, this is one interval J2. My function is defined here and here. Then if f is differentiable, restrict f to J1, at each point it is differentiable. And at each point of J2 also it is differentiable. Then I say f is differentiable on J1 union J2. Do you understand this? Yeah. Why this is meaningful? Remember, it's, I said it's an open interval. Go back. What did I say? Open interval. Do you see that? You will see why I need it. Okay. Now, remember, differentiability is a local notion. So if you give me any x, okay, I can find some delta interval around x which is completely contained in J1, then differentiability of f can be referred to only on this open interval. Similarly here, just because it's open. Okay. Now what happens if I take, okay, I can see simply take disjoint union of intervals. You understand? It may be closed or it may be open, semi-closed. Please clear your yes, because I am going to ask a question. I want to make sure that you all of you can answer. Understand this, right? Now let us look at, suppose I have an interval of this kind, okay? Minus one to zero closed and open zero to open one, okay? This is my J1, this is my J2. You understand? Now let us look at the function f of x equal to, as we did, minus 1 here and plus 1 here. See, this is minus 1 is a constant function on the interval, minus 1 open to 0 close. Therefore, it is differentiable here. And on the interval, open interval 0 to 1, 1 is constant. Therefore, it is again differentiable. But the composite function is not differentiable because it's not even continuous at 0. How many of you appreciate this point? Take some time. Do not be in a hurry. So that, to avoid this problem only, I have to assume it's open. These are the things which you don't find in textbooks. Even in my book, I didn't want to introduce that notion. Unless I teach, I don't want it to be in the textbook, because many teachers may not be able to convince the argument. Do all of you understand this? Appreciate this point? Yeah? Because when you go higher studies, you will see whenever you want to talk about differentiability, you will demand the domain should be open, whatever it may mean. Like open interval I demanded here, you will demand such a conditions later. Okay, keep this in mind. Now let's try to see like this. Suppose my thing is, let us say minus 1 to 0 and 0 to 1. Both are open interval now. Do you understand that? Is there any point common? No. Zero is not a common point. You understand that? Now suppose on this interval J1 I define it to be minus 1 and J2 I define it to be plus 1. Yeah? Is the function, what is the domain of the function? Domain of the function is J1 union J2. This is nothing other than minus 1 to plus 1 interval, but 0 deleted. Therefore, this is not an interval. Right? But let's look at f on J1, it's a constant. Therefore, take any point x in J1 union J2, either x is in J1 or x is in J2. Suppose x is in J1, then f is constant on J1, therefore f dash will be 0, f dash x will be 0. Or similarly, for x in J2, f dash x is 0. That means f dash of x is 0 for all x in J1 union J2. But the function is not a constant. Right? Why? Because the domain is only union of just open interval. So don't worry about zero. It's not there. Whereas in this case, okay, the domain had a zero because the J1 interval had zero as one of its points. Okay, please go through. This may be a subtle point. I will request you to pause, review, and proceed. If you understand about 30 to 40%, I am happy. If you understand more than that, I think you are a genius. So please clear your yes and make a fresh yes if you understand. Yes, Shubham.
Sir, in both cases, our J1 intersection J2 is phi.
It's empty.
Yes, sir. Empty. Sir,
don't say phi. Okay. If you are going to be my student, you should never say empty set as phi. Yeah.
Yes, sir. Okay, sir. Empty set. If it is not empty, then what happened? I mean,
See, look at this case, J1, where it is open at minus one, closed at zero. And J2 is open at zero and open at one. You understand? One. Now, notice that J1 and J2 are still disjoint. Do you understand that?
Yes, sir.
Even in this case, I'll just use a circle so that you can see that. Even in this case, the interval J1 intersection J2 is empty. Do you understand?
Yes, sir.
Yeah.
Okay.
So it's not only it is they are disjoint, there is something more happening.
Okay.
You understand? Now this function is not even continuous at zero. Because if I approach from the left, I get minus one. If I approach from the right, I get one. Therefore, the function is not even continuous. That's very trivial. Draw the graph, you know. But it's not continuous.
Okay.
Okay. And the derivative makes sense.
Okay. Yes, sir. Yes.
Yeah. But derivative at zero does not make sense. Because it is not even continuous. You follow that?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Whereas in this case, in the second case, let me circle with some other color. Okay. This case is well behaved. There is no problem. There is no ambiguity. Okay. That's why I said, please take some time. Do not try to understand everything now itself. Okay. I gave you an idea. If you understand 30-40%, please go through, discuss with your friends. If you have problem, you come back tomorrow.
Okay.
Okay. See, I believe that my students should be ready to think on their own also. So I will go show you the direction. Then you should travel in that path. I won't take your hold your hand and take you along the path all through. Okay. That's not the correct way of training students. Okay. Just go through, think over. Okay. That's what I said. 30-40% is good enough at the person. Okay. Is that clear to you? Now, what did we prove? What did we say to us? To show that if derivative zero implies f is a constant, I needed the domain to be a constant. Whereas here, in this second case, okay, the derivative is zero. I can define the derivative here. There is absolutely no problem. But the function is not a constant. Why? The domain is not an interval. The point minus half is here, the plus half is there. Therefore, zero is in between that. Zero has to be in the union. It's not there. Therefore, the J1 union J2 is not an interval. Therefore, what I proved is this is a very crucial condition. Do all of you appreciate this? This is very, very crucial condition. Okay. So that's the first application. Second application, all of you again know. Now again, F is from J to R. Hereafter, I will only stick to intervals, okay? The digression will not be an effect now. J is an interval. Let's assume F dash of X is positive for all X in J. Right? Then I claim F is increasing. It's actually strictly increasing. The proof is easy. Suppose you give me X less than Y in J. Both are elements of J. Then let's look at Fy minus Fx. So I have X, I have Y. Mean value theorem, what does it say? It says that there is a T in between, so that it is F dash of T into Y minus X. Now, what is my assumption about F dash? This is positive. And what is my assumption about X and Y? X is less than Y, that means Y minus X is positive. Therefore, this side is positive, right? Therefore, what does it say? If Y is greater than X, Fy is greater than Fx. Therefore, F is increasing. Similarly, if F dash X is less than 0 for all X, then F is decreasing. How many of you understand this? Please clear your things. Yeah. Very crucial. Did you see that? What we needed was, this is something. Yeah, Shashikala.
So why do you take F as an increasing function, sir, here?
I am not taking F as an increasing function. I claim it's increasing function.
Okay, sir.
Okay. Under these assumptions, conclusion is this. Under these assumptions, conclusion is F is decreasing. You understand that?
Yes, sir. Now understood, sir. Okay. Thank you, sir.
Right. It's all right. See, I don't write legibly as teachers do, because I want my students to think, so I write only very many minimum. You have to capture what I'm saying. Okay. Is that clear to all? But there is a subtle point here. I have seen some teachers missing. Suppose F from J to R differentiable, okay, and A is a point in J, and F dash A is positive, that does not mean, okay, this is A, J may be this, and here F dash A is positive, this does not mean F is going to be increasing in an interval around A minus delta to A plus delta. Okay, does not mean there exists an interval, that is, let us say A minus delta to A plus delta, on which F is increasing. Many people harbor this notion. They have this misunderstanding. That's not true. So what did we say that? The crucial thing is, this is the very crucial thing. Please pay attention. This is the assumption. The derivative must be positive at all points of the interval. Why do I need all points of the interval? Do you see that? Because when you apply the mean value theorem Fy minus Fx, there exists some t in the interval. At that point, I want F dash t to be positive. How do I know that? T could be any point, and X and Y may be any two points. Therefore, t could also be any point in the interval. Therefore, the assumption is F dash must be positive at each and every point of the interval. How many of you understand? Appreciate this point. These are the small points, you know, teachers just like that, they give the proof. You think you understood. But when you want to apply, you make this mistake. But can you give some additional condition in which this result will be true? Let me repeat. You may not be able to understand what I'm asking. Suppose F is from J to R is differentiable, and at A in J, F dash A is positive. Can you put some additional condition so that I can conclude? Now this is a true state implication. I can conclude there is an interval a minus delta to a plus delta on which f is increasing. How many of you can come up with a see, this is how you learn to think.
Sir?
Yes?
If it is a singleton set?
Huh?
Singleton set.
Singleton set, no. Singleton set, any function is a constant. Do you remember? Therefore, if at all you want to talk about derivative, it is zero. Yes?
Sir, if f is equal to the auxiliary function in that interval?
No, no. Now you see that this is how I want to make my students begin better at, right? Do you know? See, if I want to say f is increasing from the last theorem, what do I need then? There exists some interval on which f dash x, okay? There is some interval a minus delta to f plus delta on which f dash x must be positive. You understand that? If I make sure, then it will be true statement. How many of you understand what I'm saying? If I can assure there exists some interval a minus delta to a plus delta on which my f dash x is positive, then this f will be increasing on this interval. Do you understand? So, but I only know f dash a is positive, but I want to say f dash x is positive around all points x in a, around all x which are near to a. I'm sure that all of you can come up if you are gone through my continuity lectures. I have done that there.
Hello, sir.
Yes.
Can we use local properties of?
Don't use that word local property. Okay, what exactly? Okay. Say that.
Property is if f is function.
No. If you say anything about f, no. I want to conclude f dash x is positive for all x near a. So that means many of you just went through my videos just like that for fun, like watching a serial. Yeah,
sir.
You didn't pay very much attention. Do you remember I proved that if f is a continuous function from any set A to R, and if f of a is positive, a is in a, then there is a delta positive, so that a minus delta to a plus delta intersected with a, for every x here, f of x will be positive. Okay, this is the local property Animesh was talking about, but he couldn't come up with it correctly. This has nothing to do with the earlier f. Do you understand this? How many of you remember I have proved it? I am clear. Please clear and say again, because you are struggling. Do you understand? Therefore, what should be the extra condition I should impose now for the earlier example? For this example, what is the extra condition I have to impose?
F of A is positive.
Huh?
F of A is positive.
No. Huh? Where does F of A comes positive? It could even be negative.
Sir, f is locally increasing. At the interval, f is increasing.
No, I am unable to hear you properly.
Sir, if you take
whatever you say, it doesn't seem to be correct to me. You are still missing. See, I know you have.
Sir, f dash should be continuous.
Where? At A is enough.
At A,
F dash is continuous is a very good thing, but that's too much of a killing. I just need F is increasing in some interval around A. Therefore, it's enough if I assume F dash is continuous at A. If F dash is continuous at A, then what do I know? This is all I needed. F is continuous at A. Go back. Please watch my continuity video. See, just if you think line by line checking is mathematics, that's not true. And if that's the kind of mathematics you want, you should not attend my lectures. You should not see my videos. My videos are to make you think, appreciate mathematics, and so that you will become an expert. Okay, if you want to pass some exams, okay, you should go to coaching class, not to me. You see that? So if I assume, notice that f is differentiable, I am assuming, right? Therefore, f dash is a function from where to where? From j to r. Because f going to f dash makes sense because f is differentiable. Now, what do I want? This is a function. This function I want to be continuous at a. If it is continuous at a and if f dash a is positive, by the local result I just now said, there is a delta positive, so that a minus delta to a plus delta will be contained in j. On this interval, f dash will be positive. If f dash is positive on this interval, by the last result, f will be increasing in this interval, a minus delta to a plus delta. Please clear your yes, all. How many of you understand? Pause, review, and then proceed. So you are learning mathematics in depth, not just a theorem proof something and learn it by heart and produce it in an answer book, but you don't even understand what you're doing. You see that? This is the correct thing. So the interesting thing I said is I wanted this derivative should be positive at each point of the interval. Then only I can conclude it's increasing. Now the problem is different here. Many teachers make, okay, and are under the false assumption. If f dash a is positive, so f must be increasing in some, they usually use the word neighborhood, in an interval around a. That is not true. If I put an additional hypothesis, true. What is the additional hypothesis? F dash must be continuous at a. Okay. I hope all of you understand. So it's really taking a lot more time than I expected. There are quite a few things I wanted to complete, but it's becoming more and more difficult. See, this will not happen if you had been honest and took a lot of pains to go through my continuity lectures. Because in a typical course, when I give, if my student had gone through those 10 lectures of continuity, these things I can go through very, very fast. Because they had understood, assimilated, digested. So they are very confident. So one can go fast. Now what do you do? You read that, you watch that video, then you think, I know the theorem. Okay. You are not thinking along with me during those videos. That is reflected in your performance. I'm sorry if I sound, but you know, I am just giving an idea how to watch my videos hereafter. Okay. It's not for passing exam. You should begin to think along with me. Now let's do the most important thing. How many of you have watched my video on uniform continuity? Please remove your yes and say yeah, fresh. How many of you have seen? How many of you remember I have given one trick to construct a lot of uniformly continuous functions on real numbers, real life? How many of you remember that? Jyoti? So suppose f is function, this is differentiable, right? And assume there is an m positive so that for all x in j, f dash x modulus is less than or equal to m. That is the derivative is bounded function, right? That is f dash is bounded on j. When do you say a function is bounded? Its value at each and every point in modulus should be less than or equal to some constant. Okay, that's what. Then let us look at, take any x and y in J. What do I know? Fx minus fy will be f dash of t into x minus y. Okay, xy somewhere, t will be somewhere. T is a point in between. X and Y are somewhere. You understand? Now, what do I want? When I want to check, so suppose I try to put a bound for this. Mod Fx minus Fy. Okay, then what will I get? I'll get mod Fx minus Fy equal to modulus F dash T into modulus X minus Y. But F dash T modulus is less than equal to M. Therefore, this is less than equal to M into mod X minus Y. What kind of function is this? For any X and Y in J, there is a single constant M so that mod Fx minus Fy is less than equal to M times mod X minus Y. What is this function known as? Kothai?
Lipschitz function.
Yes, Lipschitz function. And since it's a Lipschitz function, it's also uniformly continuous. Because uniformly I want this to be less than epsilon, it's enough if I make this less than epsilon, that means mod X minus Y should be less than epsilon by M. That means delta should be epsilon by M. For this choice of delta, whatever X and Y you give me in J, mod Fx minus Fy is less than epsilon. Do you understand? Therefore, if F is differential function with the bounded derivative on the interval, then the function F is Lipschitz on the interval, and in particular, it's uniformly continuous on the interval. How many of you understand? Please say, remove your yes and say again. So I had already shown you three applications. Now the fourth application is a combination. There are a lot of inequalities. Okay. The very basic principle is whenever you see an inequality, okay, you should try to think of using differentiation and mean value theorem to prove inequalities. See, inequality means what? Something is less than or equal to something. So this should be some, think of as a value of a function at some point. This is a value of, suppose I want to say some alpha, some expression alpha is less than or equal to some expression beta. If I can find something like f of a less than or equal to f of b, okay, this is equal to f of b, this, then I can try to use the differentiation, mean value theorem, etc. to prove this. Okay, this is a vague point, but you should remember that. Okay. It's a standard trick. In analysis, whenever you see an inequality, try to see whether you can use differentiation and mean value theorem. Okay, I'll give an example. Some of the standard examples I'll give. Okay, suppose e power x, all of us know, and 1 plus x. I want to say e power x is greater than 1 plus x for all x in R. I don't know if it's a true statement, because I don't have a book with me or anything, but something like this should be true. Let us see. Do you understand this? We don't know whether it's true or false. Okay. Now, the moment you see an inequality, the important trick is to construct a function F for which you can use derivative and mean value theorem, etc. Do you understand? So for this inequality, what function should I think of? Okay, this is where the real lemon trick comes. With the experience, you will learn better. So I am going to think of the function fx equal to e power x. Right? Suppose I do that. Then, let us look at. Then I want 1. Notice that f of 0 is e power 0, which is 1. Therefore, what do I know? Fx minus f of 0 equal to f dash of t into x minus 0, which is x. Do all of you understand this? What is f dash of t? It is e power t into x. Yeah? This is e power x minus 1 is e power t into x. Where is t? T is between? Zero and x. Okay, I don't know which is zero, which is x. But t is somewhere in between. Okay, x may be here also, left side, or x may be on the right side. Do you understand? Okay, 0 may be less than x, or x may be less than 0. I don't know, I do not know. Do you understand this? Now, if notice that, suppose E power t, we know that is always positive. Do all of you know that? Yeah? Yeah. Now suppose x is also positive, then I know e power t. Okay. Please pay attention. So I am looking at f of x equal to e power x. I am looking at f of x minus f of 0, which is e power t into x. This is e power x minus 1 equal to e power t into x. Suppose x is positive, then I have 0, x and t. Right? Now notice that therefore it, t is greater than 0, therefore e power t is greater than 1. Therefore this is greater than x. Therefore, e power x is greater than 1 plus x. Do you follow that? Please say yes, remove your yes, and then say yes if you understand. And therefore, we have proved this inequality for all x positive. Suppose x is negative. Is it true? So, I have 0, I have x, I have t. For whatever x and t, this result is always true. You understand? Therefore, e power x minus 1 is e power t into x. Yeah? Now, I want to write something like this. That means e power x is 1 plus e power t into x. If I say this object is greater than x, greater than equal to a, greater than x, then I am through. E power x will be greater than 1 plus x. Do you understand this? So, I have to somehow say e power t x is greater than x. Now, where is t? X is negative. Therefore, t is also negative. Therefore, what do I know about e power t and 1? E power t will be less than 1. Do all of you understand? Yes? Because t is negative. Since e power t is less than 1, and where is x? X is negative. Therefore, if I multiply this inequality by a negative number, what do you think will happen? X into e power t, the inequality will be reversed into x. You understand this? Therefore, I proved it. E power x is greater than 1 plus x. So, please remove your s. If you understand, say yes again. Yeah? So, now that I applied e power x, okay, as a second application, what do you think I should look at? Its counterpart. Fx equal to log x, right? Now, I applied e power 0, therefore I get 1. Here I want to get something else. What do you think I should apply to? F of x minus what point I should look at? So that life will be easier for me.
Can f somebody guess? Log 1.
F of 1, sir.
Log 1, very good. Excellent.
F of 1.
Great. Therefore, I get log x. Very
good. Log 1.
Very good. See? This is what, you know, if you are ready to think, you can get it. Okay, this opportunity is usually denied in classroom because of time constraint. Very good. Now let's use this theorem. I don't know whether I'm going to get any inequality. You understand this? I'm just playing with it. Okay, like a child, you gave me some toy, I learned something, I just try to play. That's it. Whereas if I have a book, then I know what inequality I have to get, then I can write, we will prove this inequality. No. I do not know what inequality I want. I'm just going to play with this. So let us look at this. Therefore, this is equal to log x equal to fx minus f1, but this is equal to f dash t into x minus 1. Right? Therefore, I'm taking this to be 1 and my x, let us see. X is also greater than 1 to be on safer side at present. Do all of you understand? But what is f dash t? That is derivative of log, therefore it's 1 by t into x minus 1. Do all of you appreciate this? Now, therefore, t, where is t? T is some fellow here, between 1 and x. So, I want an inequality. So, when I want an inequality, I have to say where, so the inequality is going to arise between this, where, putting an inequality bounds for 1 by t. Do you understand this? This is the kind of thinking you should learn. I want an inequality. Then this x is fixed. And whereas t is between 1 and x. Therefore, when I want to do, I should find an estimate for t, or rather 1 by t. So 1 is less than t, less than x. Therefore, what do I get? 1 is greater than 1 by t, greater than 1 by x. Do you understand this? Yeah. Now x is greater than 1, therefore x minus 1 is positive, right? Therefore, multiply this both sides, okay, this inequality by the positive quantity x minus 1. Then what do I get? X minus 1. Am I making sure clear? 1 by t into x minus 1 is greater than x minus 1 by x. You understood that? But what is 1 by t into x minus 1? That is log x. Therefore, I have an estimate for log x. X minus 1 is greater than log x is greater than x minus 1 by x for all x greater than 1. You see? Now, I did not know what inequality I wanted. Luckily, I got it now. How many of you appreciate this? So, you should also learn to play with this kind of thing. Now that I have done for e power x and log x, then I should try something like, what should I try? Can somebody tell me?
Trigonometric functions, sir.
Trigonometric functions you can try. Yes, very good. So I leave it to you. Try on your own sin x. Okay?
Sure, sir.
Try on your own. Don't look at any book. Try something. See whether you get some inequality. Yeah? Remember, you know sin x by x. Limit x goes to 0 is 1, right? This is a well-known thing. In the calculus, that's the first thing we assume, right? So somehow, sin x is close to x, where x is near 0. Do you understand that? Therefore, what is the question I would like to ask? Can somebody tell me?
What is the interval sin x is bounded between?
No, it is going to be bounded. Sin x is always bounded, or r. It's bounded by 1 in modulus.
Yeah.
That's not the question. See, sin x by x goes to 1 as x goes to 0. Therefore, I would like to know in a neighborhood of 0, what is the relation between sin x and x? Whether sin x is less than x or sin x is greater than x or some such thing. You understand? I am giving an idea. This is how I begin to think. I do not know. Okay? So, probably you should try to explore what is the relation between sin x and x. So, I leave the thing to you to explore. Now you will see that you are discovering mathematics. Okay, you are trying to find some mathematics on your own. Not somebody does and you verify like an accountant. Now, the time seems to be running out. I want to do two more thing, but let me stick to that. Next, so trigonometric function is over. Exponential log is over. What remains next? You see that, you know, you look at any textbook, they look at some inequality and then they just like that do some exercises. Now, whereas how did they get those inequalities? They never explain. The way is, you look at automatically these kind of standard functions, try to see whether you can derive an inequality like the way I did here, the way I did for e power x. And the way for I have not done, but I showed you how what I would like to investigate. What is the relation between sin x and x? Okay. Now, can somebody tell me? I'm very surprised. This is a more important, easier function for us to deal with. Yes? Yeah? Are you following? So, I will quickly do that and stop there. Now, let's look at, let us say is 0 less than x less than y or some such thing. Because remember, again, how many of you have checked my uniform continuity lectures? I think in lecture 3, I dealt with this. Okay. I am going to prove this function is not uniformly continuous on R, but I won't have time, so I'll just integrate quickly. Now let's look at, assume actually this is greater than or equal to 1 also. Far away. The picture will be like this. So if it is far away, even a small disturbance will create a lot of disturbance in the values of the function. So y power n minus x power n equal to n into t to the power n minus 1 into y minus x. So I'm skipping that terms now. Right? Okay. So this is mean value theorem. I got it. Now, how do I use it? I used it to show the function is not uniformly continuous. Suppose it's uniformly continuous. That means, okay, you give me an epsilon positive. Let us say epsilon equal to 1. Then there exists a delta positive. So that mod x minus y less than delta should imply mod y power n minus x power n must be less than a 1. Do you understand that? Okay. This is true for every x and y. Therefore, let me start with x, which is greater than 1, and y, so that mod y minus x is less than delta, and y is actually greater than x. That means y is less than x plus delta. Okay. Let us look at this y. Apply this. Then what do I get? Y power n, this is less than 1, right? 1 is less than y power n minus x power n. There is no need for modulus. This will be positive. Sorry, 1 is greater than, right? 1 is greater than, correct. But this is equal to n into t third to the power n minus 1 into y minus x. Yeah? Right. Now, look at only this inequality now. 1 is greater than n into t to the power n minus 1 into y minus x. And fix x, which is greater than 1. And choose any y such that this happens. Then what happens? 1 is greater than n into t to the power n minus 1 into y minus x. Right? But t, this is my x, this is my y, this is my 1. T is positive and greater than x. Therefore, this fellow is greater than n into x to the power n minus 1 into y minus x. For which y? For any y which is less than or equal to x plus delta. That means 1 must be like greater than or equal to, look at the LUBs, supremum of this, as y varies in this interval, this will be delta. Therefore, greater than or equal to n into x to the power n minus 1 into delta. That means x to the power n minus 1 is less than or equal to 1 by n delta. I hope I'm writing it correctly. But remember, if n is greater than or equal to 2, then x, 1 is less than or equal to x, therefore multiply by this x, that means x is less than or equal to x squared, etc. X squared and so on. Therefore, x power n minus 1 is greater than or equal to x. Therefore, my x should be less than 1 by n times delta. Okay, you gave me an epsilon, therefore this delta is fixed and n is a fixed number, and you want to say whatever x I take greater than 1, that x must be less than 1 by n delta. That is absurd. That shows this function is not uniformly continuous. This is a fantastic thing. Please go through. This is the proof I had explained in uniform continuity 3, but I had again explained. Okay. Please go through this. I'll stop sharing. I hope all of you appreciate. You see that the mean value theorem is the single most important result in the whole thing, in the theory of differentiation.